with the sovereign compact machine.
Yes, sir, that comes along with the machine. So we just have to plug in the vitrectomy port and switch it to the vitrectomy mode and disconnect the irrigation and aspiration from the phaco probe, and the irrigation is connected to the 23 gauge cannula or a phaco cannula, visco cannula, and then the aspiration is connected to the vitrectomy probe, the port, aspiration port of the vitrectomy port. So, and with one hand you irrigate and the other hand vitrectomy probe will be the cutting and the aspiration.
How much does it cost?
Sir, it is 96,000 rupees for the probe.
And how do you autoclave this?
Sir, I generally ETO it from a higher center and keep it. In case of emergencies where I can't ETO, I autoclave it, in the sense like if I don't have enough time to ETO it.
Is it not autoclavable?
It is autoclavable, sir, but they recommend better to ETO it. The life will be better if we ETO, that's what they say.
What is the maximum cut rate which is there with this cutter?
I think around 900, sir.
Okay, so one big disadvantage is it's extremely expensive because it's a standalone unit. The entire cutter itself costs around 1 lakh rupees. So it's difficult for most of us to have 3 or 4 ready. So that is one big advantage. And this is where I would recommend that everyone, instead of having this, should have the something like a Reticare standalone anterior vitrectomy unit. Because you never know, on a single day, you may require 2 or 3 times, you know, vitrector, use of vitrector. So you should always have a standby. So that is one disadvantage with this. I've used all the machines. I've used Appa Swami, I've used Reticare, I've used another one, Aditya was there. I had all of them. And all the quality control is a major issue with the Indian manufacturers. The small niggles, you know, there is a loose connection here, there's a loose connection there. Unless and until our staff are extremely well trained to identify where the fault is, these are going to be a problem. But unlike this, although the cutting rate is very low, it is extremely efficient and fast. The disadvantage with this is it is slightly bulky, you know, it is 20 gauge. So your incisions have to be slightly bigger. Otherwise, it works pretty well. I think with that, we'll just move on to the next presentation. So I just like to share. So we are talking about all vitrectomy. I just want to go and show why it is so essential. Please let me know whether the voiceover is clear or not, because it has some voice here.
A few years back, in the year 2014, case, the 70-year-old lady operated 40 days back for cataract. She has this AC lens. The patient presented with poor vision and pain. She's come to our center for further management. Her pressures are high, 45 millimeters of mercury. The antechamber IOL is partially captured in the pupil. The diagnosis is obvious. AC IOL with pupillary block secondary glaucoma. There looks to be a probable iridectomy here, but which is not working. The cornea OCT images confirm the iris pompe and peripheral antrocyanicae. Now, surgical intervention is mandatory in this patient. My plan for this patient was to do antivitrectomy and explant the lens and consider a second implantation at the same setting or at a later date, depending upon the intraoperative scenario. I carefully make 2 side port incisions, keeping in mind the very shallow antechamber. Dispersive OVD is injected to form the antechamber and protect the endothelium. 23G cutter and an irrigating cannula are introduced into the eye to perform bimanual antivitrectomy. I gently move the cutter underneath the lens and clear the vitreous from the pupillary area. The original iridectomy site is faintly visible and becomes quite obvious when the vitreous is clear. The vitreous had plucked the original iridectomy, which probably led to the cascade of events. Triamcinolone acetate is used to identify any remaining vitreous strands. In just a few minutes of performing the antivitrectomy, the cornea looks clearer, the chamber has deepened, the iridectomy is patent, and the IOL appears to be quite well centered now. Actually, we can notice that the AC lens is in fact flipped, but that was not causing the problem, as we know. It was the vitreous which was really causing all the problem. Now, in just a few minutes, the eye is looking fine. At this point, I consider a change in plan and decide to retain the original lens and just want to wait and see how things turn out. In the immediate post-op period, There's a dramatic improvement in the clinical condition of the eye. The cornea is clear, the antechamber is deep, the pressure has returned to normal, and the patient's visual acuity has improved significantly. The patient continues to do well even after 3 years of the surgical intervention. The patient was lucky because timely surgical intervention in the form of antivitrectomy by using these two small paracentesis incision took care of all the problems. Now she continues to do well with the same antechamber intraocular lens. The IO is usually blamed as the culprit, but is just a silent bystander, while the vitreous was the main culprit. Now moving to the second case. This is a 60-year-old lady who has undergone cataract surgery 1 year back, presents with poor vision and chronic pain in the same eye. The antechamber lens is seen. What is glaringly obvious is the extremely shallow antechamber. And despite the visible iridectomy, the antechamber is shallow and the pressures are very high. The vitreous again is probably blocking the iridectomy, specular microcystic endothelial cell count. The decompensation and reverse or prevent worsening of the secondary glaucoma. Plan is to explant the lens, perform antivitrectomy. Surgical gonioscopy shows almost 360 degrees of peripheral antrocyanicae. I fashion a scleral tunnel, make two side ports, OVD is injected to the side ports to deepen the chamber, try to dissect the cyanicae and release the adhesions between the lens. The lens is freed now and the lens could be explanted quite easily. Next attempt, I'm trying to make an attempt to perform cyanicolysis. The broad areas of cyanicae require mechanical dissection. I'm using micro forceps to meticulously try and release these iridocorneal adhesions. The next step is to do vitrectomy. After triamcinolone assisted by manual pain, the cornea is clear, but the IOP is still on higher side despite being on anti-glaucoma medications. 2 months later, the corneal decompensation seems to have halted, but the secondary angle closure glaucoma does not seem to be under control. She eventually ends up requiring a glaucoma drainage device. Moral of the story, early surgical intervention in the form of antivitrectomy could have definitely yielded better outcomes in this eye, as was evident by the previous case. Finally, we have this case of a 70-year-old man who has undergone a cataract surgery elsewhere 2 months back and come for consultation because he's got pain and blurry vision. Examination reveals corneal edema, shallow antechamber, a Kelman-type antechamber intraocular lens, and the pressure is 40. He still has good vision. His best corrected vision is still 618. Pupillary block glaucoma with iris pompei and peripheral antrocyanicae. Again, a classical presentation which we have seen in our series. The patient was advised immediate surgical intervention in the form of anterior vitrectomy and restoration of the anatomy of the antesegment and explantation of the IOL if required, but the patient never turned up. One fine day, 18 months later, he comes back for consultation. It was tragic. The eye, which had a vision of 618 then, had turned PL negative now. The pressure was 46 and the cornea had decompensated. But a great potential to reverse the complication and save the eye back then had the patient consented for surgical intervention. An opportunity was lost. In all these three cases, there's a solid teaching for us. If these cases don't teach us, then nothing will. One simple technique of performing antivitrectomy would have dramatically altered the outcomes in every case.
See, the message here is, you know, the most common question asked is, I'm an SICS surgeon, should I invest in a vitrectomy machine? I don't have PC rents very frequently. Do I have to have a vitrectomy machine? I think these three cases should answer us everything. So I think the responsibility or onus on the present generation ophthalmologists is that the next generation should never see any cases like this in their career. Okay, in 2030, I don't expect that, you know, we should see any of such cases being there. So if you have people argue that, you know, there is no vitreous loss, we are not able to see vitreous. That's the reason we presume that we are not seeing vitreous. There's no vitreous loss. So we'll have much discussion on these aspects later on. Now, quickly moving on to my next presentation about the technique of anterior vitrectomy. So this presentation is going to be on a question answer basis, which I have prepared. So the first question would be the most common thing, which a phobia, which most cataract surgeons who have this is that, you know, is it technically very difficult? Do we need to be extremely skillful to perform anterior vitrectomy? Well, the answer is very obvious and it's glaring. You know, it's a big no. If you can perform a sclerocorneal tunnel and if you're able to perform a rexus, then this is a child's play. It's just a mental block, which everyone has to just, you know, get rid of. The only thing you need to learn is to understand how the machine functions and what are the quirks in this and the common problems which you see and how to fix it. That's the only issue. Nothing else is there. You just hold the irrigation and use the cutter. So obviously the cutter is cutting. You have to be careful that you don't touch any unintended structure. So that's all it is. Extremely simple. The most important aspect of anterior vitrectomy, why we are doing anterior vitrectomy, is not only to remove the vitreous, but most importantly, we would not want to cause any traction to the vitreous base. See, what is invisible to us is what is happening at the level of the retina. We're putting a sponge here and trying to cut it and try to pull it. What is invisible, we're happy that we're not doing anything. Invariably, we're going to cause a giant retinal tear, and the management of it is extremely difficult. The visual outcomes are extremely poor when we have to manage a giant retinal tear. So the fundamental goal is to remove the vitreous, but the only primary goal is to avoid any sort of traction to the retina. Now moving on to what is the basic principle of anterior vitrectomy? It's very simple. The first objective is to cut. You know, we don't want to cause any traction to the vitreous base. So first cut and then aspirate. So whenever we're aspirating, the probe has to be held still. It cannot be moved around. So always, you know, we want to have the cutting first and then aspiration later on. What is the device? Dr. Mallikarjun just showed us how the device works. Now, this is a cutter, which I use with my machine, Infinity or Centurion. And it has got different cutters. This is the Gulitone cutter, which Dr. Mallikarjun was showing. Now you have a to and fro movement, and this is what cuts the vitreous. And this is the speed at which, you know, it moves. If you set it at 100, 500 moves a little bit faster. And you have an option. The logic of using the highest cut rate is that the amount of shock waves which are transmitted to the back to the retina are minimal when we use the highest cut rate. So that is the objective of using the highest cut rate possible in our machine. So if for anterior vitrectomy, as my colleagues told, that the machine's having 900, that's all right. Whatever is there, it is there. But if you have access to a higher cut rate in your machine, always choose the highest cut rate. The obvious advantage is the shock waves are less transmitted to the retina, and hence the intended traction effect and all those things are minimized. Now moving on to the next aspect, that is irrigation cannula. Dr. MSR sir showed beautifully that how he uses a Simcoe bulb to control the irrigation. Well, most of us are not using the Simcoe bulb. What we use is a gravity-based infusion, bottle hanging there, and the irrigation cannula. What is the purpose of this irrigation cannula? Irrigation cannula is just to, you know, we want the eye to be pressurized so that the anterior chamber is maintained. And the idea is all the structures, they need to be in the normal anatomical position during the procedure. The cornea has to be at its position, the iris has to be at its position when you're cutting the vitreous or doing anything. But this is the basic principle of any intraocular surgery, as it is with anterior vitrectomy. This ensures that we cause minimal trauma to the other intraocular structures, especially the corneal endothelium. Now, moving on to the next related question, is closed chamber technique mandatory while doing an anterior vitrectomy? Typically, how we do anterior vitrectomy is we create these two side ports, which are one is for irrigation, one is for the vitrectomy cutter. If we have a main incision which is not self-sealing, better would be to suture it, whether it is a phaco incision or a SICS incision. And these two incisions ensure that we are operating in a closed chamber. The reason is we want a non-leaky incisions, simply because the vitreous has a great tendency to herniate towards a leaky wound. It comes out of it always. So that is the reason we want to create incisions which are snugly fitting And then we introduce these two things. And the closed chamber technique, what it predominantly ensures is that because the chamber is well formed and all the structures are there in their position, we get excellent visibility to manage the situation. And obviously the most advantages would be minimal trauma to the corneal endothelium, because we want a crystal clear cornea even in a case of a complicated a procedure. So this is achieved by having a closed chamber technique. Rarely we are forced to go through the main wound, especially to deal with some vitreous which is prolapsed, because it just gives better access. But ideally, the going through the main wound has to be restricted and has to be avoided in most situations. So what are the parameters to be set in the machine? This is the most commonly asked question. And as we know, we have an irrigation, cutting, and aspiration. I will begin with the most important aspect of the parameter. I believe that irrigation is the most important parameter to be set here. And look at the bottle height which is set here. It is set at 26 centimeters. So usually when you're doing a cortex aspiration, the set is around, usually we set it at 90 centimeters or above. So the principle of anterovitrectomy is we want to ensure that the infusion pressure is extremely low here. So the first thing before introducing the irrigation cannula is watch your bottle height, bring it down, because invariably you have forgotten you are in a cortex mode, it will be high. So this is the most common mistake done by most surgeons. So you've done a cortex and immediately switch to vitrectomy and you on it. What happens, a sudden gush of fluid, it just blows into the capsule and the capsular tear enlarges significantly. So this can be avoided by simply keeping a close watch on the bottle height which you're keeping. So first, always go and set your bottle height there. And next would be the cut rate. I have discussed it last, you know, highest cut rate, what your machine can afford. It is 900, it is fine. It is 4,000, it's also fine. Then moving on, lastly, you have to go into the vacuum. So the vacuum is again in variable anywhere between 100 to 400. See, basically we want a chamber which has to be stable. So we want a balance between the infusion and the outflow which is happening. So you have to choose according to whatever bottle height you have set, what is the cutting rate, and also the vacuum which you can set. So that usually anywhere between 200 to 300 should be fine for most machines. But again, it depends upon the individual machine. So you need to be careful. You have to titrate depending upon the machine and the setting which you are using there. AFR does not exist. The aspiration flow rate does not exist for Venturi machine. For the FACO machine, it is there. But ideally, you just choose the lowest possible. I set it as 10 because mine is a FACO machine. It has got a peristaltic pump. So you have an aspiration flow rate. I just set it at the lowest. It's the 10. So that should serve the purpose in most of the situations. And if you have an efficient machine which is functioning, most of these jobs can be done very easily and swiftly. So coming to the next question, what are the typical foot positions? So if you are using a FACO machine which has an irrigation which is built in, then you have got classically this first foot, first stage will be of irrigation, second will be of cutter, and third would be of aspiration. Now, if you're using a standalone machine like the one which was shown there, Reticare, the irrigation would be independent. So it is just controlled by the bottle height and the regulator which comes with the IV set. But if you're using a FACO machine, you have this option. And this is always the rule to follow, that the cutter has to be on first before you begin to aspirate. Again, the logic is we don't want to pull at the vitreous. We want to cut the vitreous first and then only aspirate it. However, there is a second option available in a few machines. There wherein you have an option of choosing the aspiration first before the cutting. We call it an IA cut mode. And we use it specifically for certain situations. Mind you, it's done only after the anterovitrectomy is performed. So we have a remnant epinucleus we want to remove. We can use this method, cortex aspiration, iridectomy, or even sometimes cutting a single strand of vitreous which is come towards the wound. So these are situations where you can use the other setting, but the most common, always the rule of the thumb is to remember that, you know, cut first and then aspirate. So now next question would be, where is the irrigation port held? So we have made two side port incisions here, and one is for irrigation and one is for the cutter. And where it is held? It is usually held just adjacent to the port here, with the fluid directed towards the angle. We don't want it to go near the posterior capsule opening. So if the posterior capsule opening is here, it is just limited to the fluid which is here. Now moving on to the next, the idea is we don't want the irrigation fluid to gush into the open posterior capsule because it may again enlarge it. Now, how do we hold the vitrector and where do we position it? It's a very extremely important point for us to understand. So this is a small animation which I've done here. So imagine this is the posterior capsule tear here, and this is the prolapsed vitreous. Our irrigation canal is here, and we're introducing our vitrectomy cutter here. So what the idea is, the principle which we want to follow is we want to cut the vitreous and pull it backwards, from front to pull it backwards. So what I'm doing here is the vitrector is positioned at the level of the posterior capsule tear or below it. So we're trying to place the cutter below it, and then we are trying to pull the vitreous which has prolapsed more anteriorly to it. The, again, the logic here is it has got two advantages. One, because the vitreous is being pulled from behind the forward vitreous, it prevents enlargement of the PC tear. And because it is being dealt in its place of origin or the place of its original presence, there's a lesser chance of causing traction to the vitreous space. So that is the reason why we position it. And the port is facing anterior. So let me just show you in one case. This is a PC tear which is there. And I've stained with triamcinolone acetate. This is the vitreous fibril which is prolapsing out here. And I'm positioning my cutter at the level of the posterior capsule. Capsule tear, and few cuts, the fibers are gone. Now it is placed behind the vitreous, and you are then, after the anterior vitreous is taken care of, the port is turned around sideways and back to deal with the surrounding vitreous. So the idea is first you take out the vitreous which is prolapsed out by placing it there, and then by doing so, you know, the advantage is we can ensure that the vitreous, the PC tear, does not enlarge again. Again, in this case, I'm placing the cutter here. This is the tear which is there. I don't know whether it's very clear, but this is a small tear which is there. A care to be taken that, you know, we don't damage the anterior capsule here. So when you're trying to do it, the rexus margin is very close. So if your cut rate is very high and vacuum and aspiration flow rate are very low, we don't catch any unintended structures. So you can preserve the integrity of the anterior capsule and then also ensure that most of the situations you can place the lens into the back, and that's what our ultimate goal is. What is the end point and how do you know it? Now, how long are you going to cut the vitreous here? So the idea is once the prolapsed vitreous is cleared and some of the vitreous which is around the posterior capsule and just below it is cleared, that's fine. But how do you clinically identify it? It's quite difficult to explain it, but what I can tell you is that, you know, the antechamber fluttering begins to occur, or micro shallowing becomes very obvious once the chamber, which was originally occupied by the vitreous and the viscoelastic, is taken care of. It is replaced by the fluid. The same amount of bottle height, the same amount of vacuum and aspiration flow rate now are not good enough because the consistency of the antechamber has changed, not its fluid. So that is indicated by this micro fluttering of the antechamber. And I just try to demonstrate in this case here. Once it is done, you know, you see these corneal folds happening, which are not seen initially. You can see these corneal folds. The eye becomes much more softer, and the AC becomes shallow. So these are the indirect clues which tell us that, you know, probably we are, the vitreous in the antechamber is totally gotten rid of. Obviously, the most mandatory thing to do is to just put dilated triamcinolone acetate and then check for it. You know, that is the sure more the most surefire way of ensuring that you are not missing out any retained vitreous fibril. So usually I use it two times, one before implanting the lens and again before closing the wounds. Again, I ensure that it's totally free of vitreous. Now moving on to the last aspect, you know, nowadays we hear and a lot about pars plana approach to doing antivitrectomy. Dr. Abhay Vasavada and Dr. David Chang have made a major role in popularizing this technique. Well, the only advantage is that, you know, because we are dealing with the vitreous from a posterior aspect, the most important principle of lesser chance of the PC tear to enlarge, that is a significant advantage. And since we are dealing with the vitreous from its physiological point, there is a lesser traction on the vitreous space. So that is one school of thought. And again, because it is away from the cornea, the corneal endothelial damage again is less likely to happen here. Let me show you one case here. This is a posterior capsule tear here. What I'm doing, I just done a peritomy here and I'm using a MVR blade, 3 millimeter posterior to the posterior limbus. it goes radially and perpendicularly directly into the sclera. There is no spheral tunnel effect here. And then I'm introducing my cutter inside and I'm just observing where it is. It is placed exactly at the level of the posterior capsulotae. Of course, the infusion is coming from the limbus. The infusion is coming from the limbal incision itself. Now, advantage here is that most often than not, we are successful in preventing the enlargement of the posterior capsulotae. Again, it's mandatory that we need to suture this. I use an 8-0 Vicryl to suture this wound. And again, we suture the conjunctiva back. So it is, you're making an extra port and that's the price you have to pay for doing a little bit of extra time. Now, this is a traumatic cataract and we have a posterior capsule tear, which is equatorial here, and there's a vitreous prolapse here. The rest of the PC is intact. Again, in this case, I decide to go ahead with my Parsplan approach. Key is to pressurize the globe with viscoelastic, the eye is soft, you know, and then I take sharp, extreme, a new MVR blade, 23G blade, which is snugly fitting to our cutter there. And then you go and do vitrectomy. Of course, the vitrectomy has to be done under direct observation. The key is to, you know, not to damage the posterior capsule, because sometimes we don't know where the posterior capsule would be. We may end up catching the posterior capsule with the cutter. So we need to be conscious of this one fact. And again, once you place the lens, I'm again suturing it. So there is no compromise as far as the integrity of the wound. There's a question like, you know, can we use a trocar cannula, which the posterior segment surgeons use? Of course, we can use it, but it's sometimes tricky when the eye is a little bit soft. You know, they use it at the beginning of the procedure. But here already we are in a slightly more, the surgery is already being started. So in this situation, my preference is always to make a stab incision and then suture it. Now, this is a case wherein I had to convert and perform an SICS incision. And even in this incision, I'm going to make a Parsplana antivitrectomy here. So again, you know, you stain the vitreous. Important point is I'm putting a scleral suture here for the scleral tunnel. I was not sure about its integrity and eye is soft. So we want a very, you know, easy entry of a sclerostomy blade to enter into the eye. So I'm just suturing it, pressurizing the eye, then enter and do vitrectomy. Vitrectomy, nothing, you just hold there and you just cut and it will just take a few minutes for us to clear the vitreous. And the irrigation is again through the your limbal incision. So you have sutured the scleral tunnel before doing this. And I remove the scleral suture again and place the lens into the sulcus and have an optic capture and then suture all the wounds, the sclerotomy and the scleral wound. And you get a result which are almost indistinguishable from a routine case. I think that's it. Let us go to discussion now. Can I have a question answer session now? Can we have question answer session?
I think before you go on, I think I should congratulate Deepak for a wonderful video. I don't think I've ever seen such a detailed instruction video on vitrectomy. This is the first time. And I hats off to you on behalf of everybody who is watching this, Dr. Deepak.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. No, yeah, because I think, let us begin by the first question. Sir, it is going to be you. After having all this, is antivitrectomy machine essential for a manual small incision cataract surgeon?
You can skip that question. You already answered that. It's a must.
So I would consider that this is the best friend of a cataract surgeon, because it saves you from so much of, you know, embarrassment if you don't handle your complications well. So that would be there. I think the question related to technique, Dr. Preeti, would you want to ask any question here?
So I have not used so many times, maybe two times in my OT, I've used vitrectomy. Sometimes the chamber gets shallower. Maybe my settings are not right. So would you like, you have already commented on that probably.
You mean to say that when you're doing vitrectomy, the chamber gets shallow?
No, when I go to the foot position 3 in the foot pedal, okay. Like when the vacuum is activated.
I think what happens is there are two or three things which can go wrong here. Obviously, there is a mismatch between the infusion and your aspiration. Okay, there's a mismatch. So this happens multiple factors. Your wound are not tight enough. Your bottle height infusion which is coming is lesser than what you are aspirating. And probably you just have to check your settings. You decrease the vacuum and decrease the flow rate. If you do that, I think it should not be an issue at all. Okay?
Yes, sir. Probably you answered that earlier.
Dr. Chetan, I think it's your turn to ask questions.
Yeah, Sometimes, may I, Deepak?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
Sometimes with these two side ports, you know, the main port opens up some if you are not careful in SACS. So that also can be the cause for this.
I think suturing is must. If you're noticing that, you suture it and then do it.
Yeah, I think.
Suture the main mount. And many times what happens, your side port incisions also might not match your vitrectomy size, because you would have made a slightly bigger one and the probe which you're using might be a slightly smaller one. So ensure that it is snugly fitting. So ensure that there is minimal leakage here.
But what to do with the side ports? We have already made it. You mean to say we make one more port
What happens is sometimes if the leakage is more, usually you can get around with it. It is not a problem, big problem. You can manage. But if it is really causing a problem, you should just hydrate that wound and create a separate small incision, provided the vitrector is small enough. Okay, again, depends on the size of the vitrector.
Maybe a radius of vacuum also.
Yeah. Dr. Chetan.
Sir, I am a single practitioner and then I do have an anterior vitrectomy machine. One point when, you know, I'm operating and this, the probe is not working or the machine gives way. How do I go about it, sir? I mean, what do I do in such a scenario?
Ravindra, sir, your call.
Yeah, you'll have to identify why the machine is not working. When it's working well for a phacoemulsification, it should work well for vitrectomy. As it was pointed out, the connectors are not probably proper, or there's a block somewhere there, or you know the probe has not been cleaned well, it's stuck inside, the material is still inside, the spring is gone, or the connectors are wrong. Sometimes, you know, like the cutting and aspiration ports, if you reverse and put it, it's not possible. There is a male and female adapters are there, but if the adapters are pulled out, these tubes are similar. So if this adapter is taken out and put into here, that's why the central one, the central core is a cutter in a vitrectomy. There are two. One vitrectomy has got one central opening and one peripheral opening. Central is for cutting. So see that the pipe that is connected to the cutter goes there. Otherwise, actually the fluid will come out through the cutting port, which should not happen. You'll have to identify why the machine is not working. Why is the machine working, or it's leaking, or then only you'll be able to rectify it. So off the surgery, after the surgery or before the surgery, when the probe is unsterile, you'll have to work on it. See, many people try to sterilize the probe by keeping it in formalin chamber or formaldehyde tablet chamber, which is not to be done. So, and the second is always dry it up before you store it, before you autoclave. We don't store anything overnight. Anything that is wet is to be autoclaved. Imagine I don't have surgery for next 2 days, still we autoclave so that everything is dried up. So wetness itself is a cause for corrosion of the metal, corrosion of the springs inside, and blocking of the tube and fungal growth inside the pipes, and the all this can happen if you store it wet. So these are a few points I can think of. I think Deepak may probably add.
What do you do about the case? Now he has a PC tear now. His machine is out. How do you deal with the case now? That was his question.
This is, you already answered it. We need to have a couple of probes. I would suggest you to buy MidLab. It's one of the most wonderful probes. And buy a probe, find out the PSI rating of your machine. And most of the machines have PSI of 30 to 35. That's the pressure it creates to cut the vitreous. And you need to have three or four. If one is not working, put another probe. So before that, you'll have to identify what happened. Is the probe at mistake or the machine at mistake? If the probe is at mistake, you take another probe. We need to have three, four probes. When you buy an autoclavable probe, so that you can keep it ready for the next use in case you have an issue. So machine, you don't need more than one. One machine is good enough. And sometimes if machine is not working, it can be an electrical fault. It can be a fuse might have blown out, or it can be connectors may be at mistake, error. So you'll have to identify why it did not work. And the probes which our mid-lap probes are adaptable to any machine. Any machine. You'll have to tell the PSI and they'll give the most appropriate number. The gauge that you'll have to buy is ideally 23. 25 is too delicate. 20 is too thick. 23 is probably the best probe that you can buy. And I've told how to manage a probe at the end of surgery. This is very important. And these are a few things that I can tell you. You always have 3-4 probes in the operation theater.
Okay, Chetan, if I had a situation where unfortunately I don't have a machine or the machine is not working properly and I have a case of PC tear and there is a definite vitreous prolapse, how would I manage? I would have just closed the case on that day. I would have closed the case and posted the case next day so that I can sort my things out. I can get the vitrectomy machine ready and then I would have done the case later tomorrow, the next day. Assuming that I don't have, I've run out of cutters or my machine is not broke or something like that. Until I arrange an alternative, I'd not implant the lens also, just leave it, close the wound and then wait for the next day until things get sorted. Now, what if I didn't have a machine? Suppose in the beginning of my career, I have not thought that the machine was still required, I've not bought. So then I would have sold my car and bought the vitrectomy machine. Okay, before I would have done this. So it's simple. Every scenario has an option here. Okay. Your case, you have a vitreous prolapse and PC tear. I don't have a business of pushing the lens inside now. Okay. I would want to know that I want to remove the cortex. I want to remove the vitreous. And until I have the right equipment, I'll close it and do. Suppose if the situation is such that I don't have a machine and I have to buy it, it takes some time. Then I close it and refer to an experienced colleague of mine to handle the case and tell the patient, sorry, I couldn't put the lens because there was a problem. I'd refer it to a friend who can do this job or he has the machine working. Sundaram Shetty, sir, you have to comment on this. You're muted, sir. I think you're muted.
Unmute, sir.
So it was muted when I was doing my confession. I have done over 100,000 surgeries without using a vitrectomy machine. And because that was the era when the iris claw lenses or the, scleral fixate, it was such a vogue. It was the anterior chamber lens. So what I used to do was to, as I told you, isolate the vitreous if there is a, and as you know, SSCS tear are not like the phaco tears, meaning it would have happened, inadvertently would have caught the PC, but you can see it, you can stop immediately. So dry aspiration of the cortex, then constrict the pupil and do a Caesar vitrectomy and ensure that with a little irrigation of this cut vitreous will come out and the shape of the pupil will give me an idea of the status of the vitreous, whether it is in the anterior chamber or not, and do a peripheral iridectomy, put an anterior chamber lens and close it, and if required put a suture. Now this was for a long time, but after you have been using this triamcinolone, I feel this open sky or the Caesar vitrectomy can be more efficient. See, end of the day, if we are trying to remove all the vitreous from the anterior chamber and from the wound, probably a constricted pupil with a Caesar vitrectomy does that job. And if you are going to put, let us say, iris claw lens, like Ravindra did, minimum vitrectomy, and the iris claw lens itself gives you the to the vitreous, whatever is in front can be taken care of. And this is also, looks like not too much, against the principle. So in case of Chetan's case, I have two options. One is do everything on the same sitting, or we do it in two sittings. Supposing there is too much of cortex and this dry aspiration is not possible and controlling this vitreous is difficult. As you suggested, maybe I will constrict the pupil and release it from the wound and the entry chamber with the scissors and close the case and get my vitrectomy machine ready and then go back and do the proper thing. It could be the lens in the sulcus or iris claw lens.
Now we have a situation. Is my screen visible, sir?
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now we have, there is a posterior capsular tear. This is the posterior capsular tear here. We have a rexus margin and I have this large chunk of epinucleus and some cortex which is remaining. Now this is a case. Now in this situation, personally, I without a vitreous cutter here, I would not want to venture anything. If it was just pure clean, there is not much of a cortex, no epinucleus, just a PC tear and probably a little bit vitreous, then probably just using a scissors would do fine. But when you have such a large amount of chunk of the cortex and the epinucleus left here, I would ensure that it is dealt in the most appropriate way. MSR sir, what is your opinion?
Yeah, I fully agree that vitrectomy is a must. But I would like to separate two issues, vitreous management and the cortical management. I think there is a question there. When both are present like this, if you take a aspiration cannula probe into that area, the priority aspiration cannula, it's easy to pull the vitreous. It'll pull the vitreous and the cortex doesn't go. So my approach in such situations is you can use triamcinolone or if you have a good microscope, you can clear the vitreous around the cortex. It goes back. You have a lot of visual signs to prove that. And then once it is done, then I will not take the probe and aspirate the cortex. I would rather take the Simcoe and aspirate the cortex. And if the vitreous comes in between when I'm doing it, I'll go back and do a vitrectomy and go back. I'll switch between the Simcoe cannula, which is manual, controlled, and the vitrectomy. And I play around with the cuts also. Cuts, I don't have the foot control. Here, I can either have linear control on the cuts or the aspiration. I would like to control the aspiration on the foot switch and keep the cutter rate constant. So with that, we'll be able to manage. And the aim of any such procedure is do not leave any cortex behind. If there is a vitreous loss, and if you manage vitreous well, and you still have a little bit of cortex left somewhere in the, either within the vitreous cavity or in the capsular bag or somewhere under the iris, I mean, it'll cause much more postoperative reaction. If you remove the entire amount of cortex and if you have taken care of the vitreous, postoperative recovery will be as smooth as a normal case. And if you want postoperative recovery to be very good, then you need to have a vitrectomy machine and follow all the rules that were, the Dr. Deepak particularly highlighted in 10 points. The 10 commandments are beautiful. I think one has to see that portion of the video again and again.
Next question, sir. I think this is again a very common scenario which encountered. Dr. Dev was supposed to ask this question. I'm not sure he's here. So let me ask it on his behalf. I have got 10 more cases. I'm a lone surgeon and 10 more cases lined up. And this case has a PC tear and vitreous prolapse. Now, what should I do? Because vitrectomy machine is not available. I'm working in a charity hospital setting or a government hospital setting where either it's not available or it's not functional. Now, this is the third or the fourth case of the list and 10 more cases are waiting now. And how do I go about? Shetty, sir.
I almost answered that, I think, that I have faced many, many times. There are not 10, there will be sometimes 30, 40 waiting.
Sir, I know that's the situation. See, your skill levels are totally different. What you see, other surgeons won't see. As you have told, you've done 100,000 eyes. You have got so much experience, okay? You don't require anything to see the vitreous. And the way you manage, the way you anticipate, it's okay. It's extremely acceptable. And your attitude towards the care of the patient is not compromised. But in a surgeon who has just finished his post-graduation, he's very keen to learn his surgery, has gone third year of his surgical practice, is there now. Now, what are the protocols you should follow here? You don't talk about from your behalf. You have managed it. You have 100,000 cases to tell. How do you want to do? I'm asking you your experience. Dr. MSR sir is going to comment, and next Dr. Mallikarjun. Because you have faced the situations in your career, what would you have done then? What is advisable now? What is advisable now?
Yeah, because this the FACO machine availability is for that moment, or he doesn't have it at all. Is he going to man?
Sir, if you do a census, 80% of the institutions in India, they don't have a functioning vitrectomy port either for FACO or the standalone. You can take it for granted.
So the one approach could be without the FACO, the vitrectomy machine, is that do it in two stages, the management. One is, as I said, the dry aspiration, that is the front opening cannula aspiration. It's very effective by using the visco and move. Now that triamcinolone, I'm sure is what he has, so that will very much stain the vitreous, and he can easily use the visco to move it away from the cortex, which is there, and then dry aspirate it as much as he can, and then constrict the pupil, as I told you, that remove it from the anterior chamber and from any in the wounds, and this triamcinolone come very handy for that, and you are doing it under a microscope anyway. So you close it for that moment, because you don't know whether that tear is too big to put a posterior chamber lens or iris claw lens or an anterior chamber lens. Now let the eye settle down, and that way it will not delay the operations of the other patients, and it will almost take the same time.
That's what I want. You say that just close the eye. You want
to say close it and plan it leisurely, and let the eye settle down, and then we take a call.
So that is an excellent suggestion, sir. Surgery should not have to be completed at the same time, at the cost of botching it up. So you can take a call. MSR sir, your call, sir.
Yeah, I would fully agree. I would stop surgery there, and if I were to be one of them, stop surgery, and there is always a backup organization, backup institution, seniors are there, so hand it over to them. That's the best way. And today I would put moxifloxacillin in the anterior chamber in such patients, because incidence of infection is little more once you've broken the posterior capsule. You may not be doing it for everybody, but then such patients need a moxifloxacillin 0.1 ml into the anterior chamber.
Dr. Mallikarjun.
Actually, I would love to do a second sitting surgery, because there we can manage the vitreous properly, and we can assess the vitreous, where is the vitreous loss, and how is the PC rent, and that actually in a CAM setting we used to do earlier, because for now the expectations of the patients are higher and all, and we try to do at the same sitting if the situation permits. But still, if you postpone the surgery for second sitting, it is very good, because the angry looking vitreous will settle down, and there is a tendency for the vitreous to go back, retract back. And after some time, you can assess and see how is the vitreous loss and PC rent, and manage it properly. And also you can correct your vitrectomy machine at the same time. And I feel it is better to do a second sitting.
Yeah, I think the take home message here is that there is not a compulsion that you need to complete the surgery in the cell, because if you're already stressed with the existing list and your infrastructure is not good enough, you can always convince the patient and ensure that it is being done in his best interest, in his or her best interest. And it's our responsibility to take the patient to our higher center, our own higher center, or any other, get the thing settled down. You'll be amazed at the outcomes of a properly managed PC tear with vitreous prolapse are almost indistinguishable from a routine case. I think this should be the message here. Now we move on to the open sky vitrectomy. Dr. Chetan Sadanand. So he's, Chetan, are you going to ask the question? I think Dr. MSR sir tried to, Dr. Shetty sir tried to answer that question. Chetan, please.
Sir, how to go about doing a good open sky anterior vitrectomy? case when things not available, and say, sir, we go and do surgeries in an outreach camp, where the patient comes to us with great difficulty, and closing the case and referring them elsewhere to a city where the things are available, we might lose the patient the way you showed us, sir. The patient came after 18 months, and then we can lose that patient there. So is there a way that we can do a good anterior vitrectomy, that is open sky, in such patients who are not ready to come out for higher centers or where the machines are available? Or is it a clear no for an open sky anterior vitrectomy?
No, it is going to be the last resort. That's what I feel. The open sky vitrectomy, I'll just try to share, if at all you have to do it. I thought, I just did some literature survey here, and I found out that in the late 70s and the late 60s, that was a technique which was being followed and published. And they had a way of managing it, because that time the vitrectomy was still not yet discovered. So probably I had to go back and refer and try to understand how those people were trying to do it. Again, the principle, I'll just show you the case which you had presented last week.
In the first case. And
just a second. I think this is Dr. Sushil's case. Now, this is the way you are doing the open sky vitrectomy using a vanus scissors. Okay. So the vitreous is come out here, and you're not pulling at the vitreous, but you're trying to engage the vitreous with the swab. I think this has to be minimized or advised, because whatever you do, all these maneuvers are going to cause a traction which is not visible now. It's an acute traction which you're causing here. And now what you're doing is you're using a scissors to cut the vitreous. Apparently there doesn't seem to be any visible cortex or epinucleus here, but unfortunately the pupil has also come down. We don't know what is there inside here. So in such a situation, how do you go about and do it? So see, when you do it like this, there are two or three things which are compromised. Your scissors is going to be very close to the corneal endothelium. So if we want a very crystal clear cornea the next time, we want to ensure that the chamber is maintained. And secondly, we would want to see where the vitreous is rather than just cutting it blindly. As Dr. Shetty sir just commented, just use the transfemoral estate to stay, identify where it is, and then probably use the scissors. And let me just show you one animation which I tried to do and see whether we can apply the same principles. It is not an open sky vitrectomy, I would like, because you are having still want to maintain a semi-closed chamber here. Now imagine this is the capsule and this is the vitreous which is prolapsed. And again, I would always like to use an infusion cannula here with very, very low bottle height, very, very trickling. I want to maintain the chamber, and I would want to use a micro scissors through a side port, not the vanus to the main wound. Okay. So I'd want to use a micro scissors using a separate 23G cutter, stay in the vitreous, identify where it is. The chamber is being maintained by a trickle of this irrigation fluid. We can as well use the viscoelastic, and mind you, viscoelastic is not stained by transfemoral acetate. Use a side port and then cut the vitreous through the micro scissors, using a micro scissors. Again, it's extremely critical. There's no point in you opening up the wound and cutting it. That is going to cause, it's going to be very extremely uncontrolled, and it's not going to serve any purpose. You're going to cause more damage than anything else. Use a transfemoral stain, try to irrigate through this, or try to maintain the chamber with viscoelastic and then cut, and hope that whatever is cut is flushed out by this slow irrigation out, and this prolapsed vitreous is going to flush down. But this is possible only if the entire bag is devoid of any cortex, any epinucleus, nothing is there. Only few strands of vitreous are there. That's the only place where, as a last resort, I would recommend this. Other than that, I don't think there is any excuse whether we are doing in camp or any other place, because you think the vitreous is not there and you put a lens, whether it's an AC lens or PC lens. A combination of cortex and vitreous is extreme enough to realize what is there and what is not there. Ultimate goal is to just push in the lens, and that is probably the greatest greatest harm we can do, rather than just leaving him affected and suturing him. My thoughts.
Yes, sir.
My thoughts. So,
yes, sir.
Shetty sir, or Mallikarjun, if you want to add anything to this, you can please do.
No, the in a dilated pupil, Chetan, it is not easy to control the vitreous. And of course, in SSCS situation in the wide wound, first thing is to release all the pressure on the globe. That is, many a time, either it is a speculum or the rectus sutures or whatever, you know, which is really making the vitreous come out up to the wound. See, a tear not necessarily mean that the vitreous will start gushing out. It can just be there, you know, even, you know, behind the bag also. So, what first thing is to do is that to, you know, release all those pressure, this thing. And for me, with a dilated pupil, controlling the vitreous is almost impossible. That is, you know, it's a disaster. So, that's why, as I said, the constriction of the pupil is one, that will give you one barrier, you know, between anterior and posterior chamber. So, that is where you have some control on this vitreous coming into the anterior chamber. But as Deepak pointed out, this constriction has to wait if there are cortex. If you are able to push this vitreous back and create a space between the vitreous and the cortex, the dry aspiration is the way to remove as much of the cortex as possible. Once you have done that, constrict the pupil and then go after the vitreous. So remove it from the anterior chamber. Then this vitreous is as safe as in ICC times. So we always have seen vitreous in the anterior chamber, but it was harmless in terms of causing. I know Ravindra is giving a smile, but these are all we lived through. What control we have on that vitreous in an ICC situation? It will, if he wants to come to the anterior chamber, it will come. So, but we used to say that, with the intact hyoid is more dangerous to the endothelium, so rupture the anterior hyoid, so that vitreous is safe, So, those are the days. Now, constrict the pupil, remove it from any traction, that is from the wound, that we all know, that you can, vitreous fibers can contract and pull on the base of the vitreous, etc. So, and Triamcinolone is a very handy tool in the absence of the machine. It probably can clear 100% of the vitreous from the entry chamber. So, let it be there, settle down, let the eye settle down, and you will come back for a second trial according to what is your.
So in this particular case, I had removed all the cortex. In fact, did a dry aspiration, and then started doing this anterior vitrectomy using Vanner because that was what was available there. And I did use triamcinolone acetate, but I should have, according to Sir Deepak Sir, I should have used it a little earlier to visualize the vitreous. I did use it at the end of the procedure to make sure that the vitreous strand was not there. There was one vitreous strand which was going to the side port, which I had to cut, and then I closed the case, sir. I mean, I did do a complete cortical wash. I did do a dry aspiration also. I was told to present this case for 3 minutes, so I had to cut down a lot of things. I just showed that, pupil was dilated, there was no cortex, and then I did do a dry aspiration in this particular case.
You can even finish the PI and come out also.
I think the take home message here would be there's no compulsion that you are forced to finish the case in the first setting itself. There are sometimes it is wise enough to just back off, and then when your thought process is right, everything, you can take proper decisions, because I think it's all about the attitude, which I have learned from my teachers. My teachers are, two of them are here, Dr. Sundaram Shetty sir and Dr. M.S. Ravindra sir. And I have learned from what their attitude was. And M.S. Ravindra sir, in one of his lectures 15 years back, had told, we need to learn to value vision. Okay? That stuck into my head so much. Ultimately, the one answer to every problem is, if we learn to value vision of our patients, then everything will be set inside. Okay? This is what he taught all of us. I'm one of us, many Eklavyas which are here. Sundaram Shetty sir has held my hand and taught me cataract surgery. And MSR sir has taught us so many invaluable things. the message here is not technical. Technical, most of the things we learn somehow. The first thing is to train our mind to develop the right attitude. I think if you have the right attitude, everything falls into place. So if you want to pass on to the next generation, we should be telling them that there are, you know, significantly better and much more scientifically accepted ways of managing complication. See, the world is looking at us as SICS surgeons. You know, world is looking at, we don't know, they're learning SICS from us, and we can't show them open sky vitrectomy at this stage. Yeah. We have to practice what is accepted scientifically worldwide. That is my.
We have to move with the time, and absolutely, yes. I agree with you that now, even affordability wise or anything, there is no reason why we can't have a vitrectomy machine.
See, sir, affordability is not an issue. Majority delegates here are having iPhones and have their own cars. What is the cost of an anterior vitrectomy machine car? Affordability is not an issue.
And this is going to bring returns. It is not like a car that it will depreciate every year.
Yeah, so I would have sold my car and bought a machine. That's the thing. You know, I learned from all you people. This is all what I learned from you.
Now I fully endorse the, you know, proper vitrectomy, and if possible, put the lens in the bag, you know. It's not such an important thing to do, but then if it is possible.
Deepak,
I was doing this for education. I do have a vitrectomy machine which I carry to all the peripheral camps. I am carrying it for. We are doing outreach camps, sir. We take up these PHCs, convert it to the OT 1 week prayer, go there and operate. So I am carrying a vitrectomy machine with me to every camp that I go. This was a point that I wanted to raise so that, you know, we get a discussion out of it.
Oh, this is the most practical question which you had. Thank you for asking this, because this is not really the problem. Most of the time, this is the most what happens everywhere. This is a problem. It's a very relevant question. Thank you for asking it. MSR, sir.
Yeah, see, the two things, how much of vitrectomy we're going to do it. It's probably 0.1 ml or 0.2 ml of vitreous you're going to remove. You're not like a vitrectomy, complete vitrectomy, where we remove 3.5, 4 ml of vitreous. This is a very small amount of vitreous we're going to remove. It has to be removed in time. The next thing is that there's a question, why does the posterior capsule enlarge as you're doing vitrectomy? I think Deepak has already answered. There's a question there. And if you direct the infusion towards the port, towards the tear in the posterior capsule, there's a pressure gush which goes behind. The vitreous can get hydrated, and then it swells up, and then more vitreous can come anteriorly. The first point, your infusion direction has to be to an area on the surface of iris or to an area where there's no rent. Deepak told in one of the commandments that you should not direct it posteriorly, it should be horizontally placed, and it should not be directed towards the rent. This one minimizes the amount of fluid that goes into the vitreous cavity, number one. Number two is, if you're cutting it, start the cutting behind the plane of posterior capsular rent. Take the probe till that time. So whatever that's obviously has come out from the tunnel, you clear it up. Then once in the AC, you can cut, but do not aspirate in the anterior chamber. Keep cutting, go to the rent, go behind the rent, then you start cutting it. And as the eye collapses, the infusion. I think, Deepak, there is a huge amount of control that's necessary in the infusion amount. So that's why I have an option of putting an AC maintainer and connecting it to the bottle. But over and above it, I would prefer to control the infusion also. All the three are well balanced, infusion, aspiration, and cutting. Cutting rate is all right, but where you cut it, you cut behind the rent in the posterior capsule so that you're going to this thing. The moment the rent is enlarging, that means the invisible vitreous is coming anteriorly from behind for some reason, and that is the one which is stretching it. You know, the rent is like that. So as you do vitrectomy, rent should close down. But if the rent is enlarging it, that means more vitreous is coming from behind to the front. That is, technically you're not doing it at the right place. I think there is a question. I've tried to answer it.
There's a question by Dr. Parvez. Sir, if I have a PCR with vitreous prolapse, I still have some nucleus remaining. Can I get away without making a large opening and manually delivering it? I'm not sure whether you're telling that, you know, you can leave the nucleus behind. If you can't leave the nucleus behind, of course you can't leave the nucleus behind. You have to remove it. There's no escape for that. You need to maneuver the nucleus out of the bag, and then if you don't have a vitrectomy, suture it and then post it for a vitrectomy next day. Otherwise, leave everything there, just suture it and come out. It can always be managed later. Dr. Shilpa, yeah. I think you were supposed to answer one question.
Yes, but that question is already answered. It was like beginner's mistakes doing anti-vitrectomy.
Yeah, we are not tackled that. You can just tell us now. What are
the biggest mistake what a beginner would do is avoid is not to panic or have any gestures that hint at that some mishap has happened. A panic surgeon and a panic patient is a very deadly combination. And all the things that should be avoided, it starts being a calmer mind. The second thing what I would like to say, as everyone has pointed out, that the chamber should be adequately filled. It should not be too taut or too shallow, so that it's allowing vitreous to prolapse out. Third thing I would like to say that we should not exert any traction at the ports. All the ports are important. Usually I start doing vitrectomy at the ports so that the external traction is taken care of, and then I enter into the chamber through the smallest opening, because if someone is trapped, wants to escape out of a room, we'll prefer a door and not the windows. So that is how we are going to do vitrectomy through a smaller port. The next thing I would like to point out, that we are not going to do core vitrectomy. So only the vitrectomy or vitreous that is prolapsed anteriorly is supposed to be removed, not taking out larger amount of vitreous so that it is making your globe hypotonous and making the next steps even complicated. I guess that answers the question.
Thank you, Dr. Shilpa. Dr. Pradeep is asking difference between electric cutter vitrectomy and the compressor vitrectomy machine, which is good. I think there is no doubt that, you know, the pneumatic cutters, that's a compressor based, air based cutters, are definitely far more efficient than the electric cutters one, because there is not enough power to generate the cutting movement. So I don't think you can go beyond 900 or 1200 in an electric cutter vitrectomy unit. It's an okay thing for your anterior vitrectomy. It does the job, but best would be to have an compressor based vitrectomy unit.
And also nowadays
this electric cutter vitrector, is it portable enough?
Sir, what you have is an electric cutter. What you have.
I know, but you know, it is with the FECO machine, but. Yeah. The one I think Mallikarjun showed is the electric one, isn't it?
No, that is pneumatic, sir.
Pneumatic.
That is pneumatic only.
Pneumatic.
Electric.
Pneumatic, sir. Sir, most of the cutters are available nowadays are the pneumatic, and electrical cutters are slowly coming down, sir. I think first it was the electrical cutters. Now most of the cutters are coming with the pneumatic cutters.
Dr. Deepak, there was one electrical cutter which is battery operated. Yes. I had seen it there, which is used for endophthalmitis to collect the vitreous sample. So that operates on the battery. See, yes. We in ophthalmology, we have huge machines having HP powers, and then ultimately the amount of force you need to cut the vitreous is very small. See, I wonder, whenever I have a shave in the morning, when the electric shaver can, you know, we can have 10 shaves. And when, you know, I've asked so many people to develop a unit, like an electric toothbrush is there, which operates on two cells. It should be extremely easy to manufacture an electrical cutter, which removes 0.1, 0.2, 0.5 of this thing, disposable. You just cut it.
Disposable ones, I think somewhere, I think I remember seeing one. Is one
It is available in UK. It's available in UK.
Yes.
It's not available in India.
Okay.
No, it's not a hi-fi. It's very easy to make it. It's extremely.
So, Chetan, for your these camps and all, a portable one you should look for, which you can carry along.
No, it should not. It should not cost more than 400, 500 rupees. A vitrector, a handheld vitrector. That's all the components. There's nothing in it actually. Is a spring?
You put the scroll in Amazon, you'll find one.
I've asked so many people to manufacture, they try to do something and, you know, ultimately nobody's interested because they say there is no demand for it. It should be very easy to make. You all seen that corneal burr, which rotates magnetic burr. I mean, it's something like that. The power that needs is very small. We don't need a big compressor, you know, like the entire energy coming down. Ultimately, the energy that's used at the tip of the vitrectomy machine is extremely small.
They have this cautery also in the same way, battery operated.
Yes.
One time, you know, disposable. Yeah. Disposable. I have seen them.
Yeah, I think.
This vitrectomy is site saving, sir. They should have one. We should have one. This is site saving.
We will develop. I'll look into it seriously and see that it's available. I've suggested so many people, I'll have to just follow it.
Last few questions, sir. Few fragments remaining in PC tail. By doing vitrectomy, I fear fragments may drop into vitreous. Is this true? The answer would be vitreous actually is the one which is supporting the nucleus. So if the nucleus is there, vitreous prolapse, and you just go ahead and do a closed chamber vitrectomy and the support is gone, the nucleus can drop if the PC tear is very huge. So that is expected. So first thing what you have to do is always tamponade the area with a viscoelastic, maneuver the nucleus out into a safer zone, and then deal with the vitreous. You are right. If you go ahead with the closed chamber vitrectomy and the vitreous and the nucleus are together, when the vitreous is cleared, the net has gone and the nucleus is going to drop down. It's going to happen. Next question is, my question was, if I have a nucleus space remaining when I have vitreous, how do I go about? Dr. Mallikarjun, can you take this question? Dr. Parvez Tank is asking this.
No, it depends if the how much big is the nucleus. If it is a small nucleus, as you said, nucleus, you can just set this aside and do a vitrectomy, proper vitrectomy. Only thing is, when you do a good vitrectomy, there is a space for it to go down, though that you have to take care. But once you do a proper vitrectomy, it is as good as the normal eye, just like and with a tear in the posterior capsule. That you have to keep in mind and manage it. So take care that it won't come, the nucleus piece don't come into the center. It is in the periphery, and you can use a viscoelastic there and you can remove it, or you can, if it is a big chunk, you can use some instrument and take it out. The only thing what you have to remember is, when you do a good vitrectomy, the eye is a little bit hypotony, but as good as normal eye with a opening in the posterior capsule. Then you assess it, whether you can put IOL or not, whether you can put in the bag or in the sulcus, and depending on the PC rent and the whatever support is there in the capsule.
Mallikarjun, actually, I think he's asking like this, you know, how can I clear the vitreous first and then use phaco probe again? Or will it be wise to enlarge the main port to deliver the pieces and tackle the vitreous?
No, the question actually is not for a SSCS case, because piece of nucleus very rarely stays back if you are doing a sandwich technique. Yeah.
So this is an MSSICS forum. But nevertheless, I think it is dangerous to go with the phaco probe when the vitreous is there. So it is contraindicated, total contraindicated, because you're going to suck the vitreous there. So best wise would be just to deliver the pieces out, suture the wound, and then tackle the vitreous later on.
Just to continue the discussion, the first question they ask me, what should I do when I notice the PC rent? First, what should be the first step I should do? I usually tell our trainees and fellows, first thing you should do is sing your favorite song. Get back and sing your favorite song. Relax a little bit. Then definitely your mind will work.
Let not the patient hear that.
Yes, sir. In your mind, you sing your favorite song. You are usually what I do. Kishore Kumar is my favorite singer. I sing a small song in the night, and then you can think about the situation. Definitely, your mind will work, and you will do a better job.
The moment you start singing Kishore Kumar, your people will start doing preparing vitrectomy machine, I think.
Sir, how long can we delay the vitrectomy? Like, if you're closing the case, the maximum time, and any specific instructions for the patient, how to lie down, back, supine position, or
See, if the sir, MSR sir, you can take the question.
Yeah, the as far as position is concerned, see the nucleus is not going to go drop or something like that because the buoyancy is there. It's not in the air to fall it down. So position doesn't really matter. The maximum amount of topical steroids and homotropin is what I like. Homotropin has to be given to the patient to reduce inflammation. As far as the time, there was a lot of debate, 1 week, 2 weeks, some people said 3 weeks. But there is an element of inflammation the moment the surgery is over and you've sent him out. Inflammation is triggered in. So I would personally prefer to do it on the same day if it is possible, or at least on the next day. There's no point in postponing it any length of time. What are you going to achieve? So you have a backup facilities, some, you know, transport him to the main hospital or wherever the referral has to be made, request him and ask him to come back. If there is a long list of surgery, I would like to take him on the same day. In the meantime, you finish other surgeries and ask the vitreoretinal surgeon to be ready and come back and finish it off. And I wouldn't like any waiting at all. Earlier, the better.
The concern is inflammation, post-op inflammation and secondary glaucoma. Dr. Chetan has asked the same question. Now, what medication should I do it before I refer to a higher center? I think we are concerned about two issues, inflammation and glaucoma. Because you are putting viscoelastic, there is going to be rise pressure. So medication should be directed at these two problems and then get it sorted out as early as possible.
Another question. And the cornea also needs to be cleared before the second procedure.
Yeah, see, assuming, MSR is standing like that because he would not have disturbed the cornea at all. So the cornea would be still crystal clear the next day. So assuming a beginner surgeon has done, then obviously you have to wait for 15 days for the cornea to clear to even venture something else. So it depends upon how, that's the reason why leave it just like that rather than messing it up before. You know, just leave it just like that and plan it out later. See, your point is right. The cornea would not be clear if a beginner surgeon would have handled it. Next question, how to manage vitreous which comes after implanting the lens in the bag? The idea is, you know, where the vitreous has come from. Either it has come from a peripheral PCTA which you're not able to visualize, or the vitreous has come transzonularly. It can happen then, that also. This is possible to diagnose if your pupil is very well dilated. So what you do is, you just put in triamcinolone acetate and then identify the vitreous which is there. And do a cut and then that's it. You have to just cut it out and that usually it settles down. And if the lens is not decentering and it is settled well and you're clear that the vitreous is out of the bag surrounding areas, then you should be fine. But if there's a large PC tear which you have missed initially and put in the lens, the moment you try to do vitrectomy, the lens starts to decenter and then you know that, you know, the PC tear is visible and then you have to probably remove the lens or otherwise. If the lens is very well centered in the bag, just do the cutter vitrectomy and it will be fine, no problem.
No, what I think from the posterior approach, it is better, sir, after putting the lens.
Not always necessary. See, why you want to unnecessarily make an additional port? It just takes from this, if it is accessible through your port, many times it is there, you just have accessible. If sometimes there's a large zonular dialysis and it is coming from that side, and then it is difficult to access, then that is probably the only indication where you would want to go from behind. Small streak of vitreous, you can deal with this. First, try to deal with the anterior approach. If it doesn't, then you always have that option.
So how do we counsel the patient if we're going to take the patient for surgery next day? We're going to close.
MSR, sir, the most experienced mind should answer this question.
No, I think we have discussed this in the last video. We have elaborative discussion on this. I think it was decided that we tell the patient that certain things were there in the eye, which we could not complete the surgery, and then it needs additional trained people, or it needs two people to work on, and we're just going to buy time. And even if the cornea is edematous, you can always put hypertonic eye drops and clear it up. And moment you reduce the pressure, cornea clears up. During surgery itself, we have seen many times cornea clears up the moment the fluid starts circulating in the anterior chamber. Basically, without a guilt feeling, because you did not create it, it's not a homicidal effort on the eye. Doctors should, these are things which can happen, known complications. And you'll have to go and talk to the patient, be seated in front of him and be very clear with him that we could not complete the surgery for various reasons, and explain him what's going to happen. I think don't charge them. That's what I keep telling. All these complications, there is an additional expenditure, additional follow-ups. Do not charge them. The patients are really worried because when you say something has happened, am I going to pay another, you know, amount of money? So that you make it very clear. Tell them that we're going to do the best. And antibiotics are very essential because these are the people who can go wrong. You can even start on systemic antibiotics for these patients. Systemic steroids can be started if there is a lot of cortics inside, depending upon his medical condition. And facing them is something which you'll have to learn from your seniors. And if a junior has done the surgery, it's the onus on the chief surgeon or senior surgeon to go and talk to the patient.
Thank you, sir.
How do I shuffle between IA cut and cut IA mode where there is vitreous with significant cortex remaining? See, as I explained in the video, I think the thumb rule is that you always irrigation, cut, and then aspiration. That's the thumb rule. So you're dealing with the cortex only when the vitreous has been totally taken care of. So again, you before trying to aspirate the cortex, because as Ravindra sir was telling, the moment you want to aspirate, vitreous is the first thing which is going to come. So you need to be definitely sure that the vitreous is totally gone back and there is no vitreous there. And then you can change to the aspiration mode first and then cut aspiration mode later on. Dr. Vishwanath Reddy has a question, how to manage expulsive-like situations along with VL? Touch wood, I have not had until a situation like that, but I guess early diagnosis is the most important key. If you think everything is coming out and you think you just close, suture it, that's the only thing which you could do. Because SICS wound is too big a wound to close with your thumb or anything. Just start suturing. Just the moment you think that, you know, the iris is coming out and vitreous is coming out, you have to start suturing it. Nothing else can be done. Sir, MSR, sir.
I remember Dr. Daljit Singh saying us that put your thumb on the eye. Wherever I put a thumb on it and don't come out for a couple of minutes time. Do not even take it out and see what. Whatever stage of surgery, if there is there, apply pressure on the front. But then vitreous expulsive hemorrhage doesn't come like that. It's a slow process. If you're doing it on topical or a mild block, the first thing the patient says is pain in the brow. Whenever a patient says there's a pain in the brow, stop your surgery and watch what is being done. You know, this I've faced on two occasions. The brow pain is very severe. The patient, you know, will start complaining. But if the block is too good, the patient may not feel the brow pain. This is one advantage of topical anesthesia. And if you see things coming up, you basically stop the surgery. SICS tunnel, I would beg to differ from Dr. Deepak. They're very safe, extremely safe. They don't leak at all. The moment you take it out, the moment you take out your instruments from the eye, there's nothing leaking. And just close it with your finger, wait for some time, see what's happening. 3 minutes, 4 minutes is all right. And if the pressure is still increasing, what I've done in the last case is, we have the indirect ophthalmoscope. I had a look at the fundus. Dilated people, you can easily see it. And then if there is no choroidal bleeding, you obviously there's no choroidal engorgement, you can do a passplenar vitrectomy, very limited. Only a few strokes are good enough. The pressure comes down drastically and you can continue the surgery. So this is the intraoperative hard eye, where the misdirection syndrome, that's the time when, you know, I thought of misdirection, fluid, your own BS is going between the, you know, through the zonular apparatus in the vitreous cavity and raising it. But if it is a true expulsive, you're bound to stop the surgery and close it up, put a couple of stitches. I think Daljit Singh had, in every surgery, he has got three or four. That time we were doing ECC, large incisions. So he used to keep needles ready in case expulsive, he puts all of them. He doesn't even take a bite. Take twice needles and put the needles first. And then you have time to tie the, he uses stainless steel, 30 microns steel wire, and he used to tie. But first put the steel, needles across the suction. So these are a few things that you can look at.
Dr. Shaurya.
In closed chamber surgery is like SICS is a semi-closed chamber surgery and FACO is a closed chamber. That incidence of expulsive hemorrhage is slowly coming down. Isn't it, sir? Dr. MS sir and Sundaram Shetty sir, because you have seen all the year of surgeries.
Yeah, they're certainly much, much lower. We don't see them. We don't see them.
And even the management is easier than ECC days. Like, as you said, Ravindra said, you take out the instruments, you have a closed chamber. So you can always manage so much more easily. But thank God for that. I hardly remember having an expulsion in each case.
Basically, there will be a patients, lot of choroiditis, choroidal scarring, and high blood pressure. And one factor is the choroid swells up when there is hypoxia. So ensure that patient is well oxygenated. And you can even push oxygen into the oxygen catheter near the nostril to reduce the hypoxia. Hypoxia can cause choroidal engorgement and the obese patients. All these patients have defective choroids, basically. They have the tendency for choroidal hemorrhage.
One last question. Shaurya Singh is asking, how do you counsel for diminution of vision when you have a complication?
How do you
counsel the patient for diminished vision? Sir, you can only answer. Shetty, sir. How do you tell?
Well, for us, one time, when it was PLPR cases only, then it was very easy. It is always better than before. But then, it's not an easy question to answer, because even if we ask the patient to wear, the corrective glasses for the residual refractive error, they will tell you, I was told that when you put the intraocular lenses, you do not have to wear glasses. So the expectation level is quite high. It is a challenge. And my approach is to maybe take extra 2-5 minutes and explain, maybe draw the picture and tell, this is what we did. And these are the requirements to see 100% right from, cornea lens and to the retina. And we have only dealt with the cataract part of it, other problems which comes even if it is elderly patient with the age, etc., is not taken care of. Some are not reversible as well. But if there are something which has happened due to the surgery, like maybe the cystoid macular edema and all that, that is where, I think the questionnaire was, I think, towards that, I think, no, Deepak? You must be wondering whether it is this one. So we have to explain to them that certain percentage of them may, turn out to be. But with this, for example, we are talking about vitreous loss and PC tear, I think the incidence is going to be higher in such cases. So when we are telling them about this complication, we must also tell them about this possibility of vision not being 100%. But, during a course of time, it is going to be better, etc. So I think there is no shortcut in that. Maybe you will sweat a little bit on the back of your neck, etc., while telling all this. But then I think what has to be told should be told, instead of keeping it, try to, sideline the main issue. So I don't see any other way. Because it is always better that the surgeon who has operated tells everything to the patient than they find out from somebody else, like maybe out of a second opinion they definitely will go for.
Okay, sir. I think we are 11 o'clock now. I think we should close. We are again... there's still 65 people with us today. We are still anyway. Thank you all for... Dr. Pradeep, I think, would you like to conclude?
Yes, sir. It was a wonderful session and had a nice discussion. And I feel today was one of the most important day for all the anterior segment surgeons and should be marked with golden letters. Because first of all, the PCR is nightmare, and using anterior vitrectomy machine is also a nightmare. And this was dealt extensively today. and all the fear factor was removed. And we also had the experience of visiting all the four hospitals, how they go to five hospitals, how did they manage, and how do they use their vitrectomy machines. And in this just 2 to 3 hours, it is highly experienceful. What I feel is everyone should have an antervitrectomy machine, and everyone should have a mock drill so that any complication occurs, so that the surgeon and the hospital staff should be ready with the antervitrectomy machine. And there is no excuses for not doing antervitrectomy. And if in case we are not able to manage, at least close the case and refer to IA center so that it can be dealt well. And I thank all the speakers for presenting and enlightening for all of us. I thank Ravi Kulkarni sir, Mallikarjun Aralgi sir, Sundaram Shetty sir, MS Ravindra sir, and Preeti madam. And last but not the least, I thank Dr. Deepak Megur sir for his extensive video and question and answer session. And I thank all the participants for staying awake till 11 p.m. Thank you all.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Good night. Good night.
Good night, sir. Good night.